So just so everyone knows, we're recording, and Jan invited me to introduce Tommaso, and I'm really pleased to do that. I teach in the Department of Film and Media Studies at UC Santa Barbara, down the hall, even though we're all kind of far away from each other at this point. And I'm really pleased to present Tommaso Durante, who is associate lecturer in global media studies at University of Melbourne. And many of you have perhaps known him. He's taught at many different places in Europe, at the Freie Universität at Berlin, in Leipzig, among other universities. And the focus of his research has been on history and theory at the crossroads of global urban and media studies. And there were some notes about a couple of websites that I'll put in the chat where some of his work is available. The first one is the Visual Archive Project of the Global Imaginary. And the second website that he's noted is Visual Global Politics, where some of his photographs and video are available. And I'll put those in as well. So Jan, I don't know if there was anything else that you'd like to say before we get started and Tommaso starts presenting his paper, The Global and the Visual.
Welcome everybody, Tommaso, welcome and good morning.
Thank you. Here in Melbourne, Australia, it is 7:30 in the morning of a Thursday, the 28th of January. So I am doing a shift night. In some way, here we are already in the future. So good afternoon, everyone are in Los Angeles, in Santa Barbara. I am delighted to be to have been invited by Jan to join the Global Studies Colloquium series to share what I know about the dangerous liaison between the global and the visual. And I hope that you will enjoy the brief journey. But let me start with a claim. Visual images, both still and moving, play an increasingly crucial role in the symbolic and social construction of people's common sense of the global. This is because images, as you know, are not only images, but they convey ideas, old views, ideologies that promotes self-attitude at the conscious as well as at unconscious levels. Something, just a moment, please, with the slides. There is something that's not working. Yeah, thank you. These images are powerful and effective devices that contribute to understand the world in which we live, but the surplus value of images, what historian and media theorist W.J.T. Mitchell defined it, it is not easy to grasp. This is because images are polysemic, complex visual constructs, very different from a statement. So unless images are expressly valued, it is difficult to appreciate them. What is more, let me observe that even though visual images can be understood as the factor driving globalization or are the result of their consequences, it is paradoxical that scholars in the field of international relations and new global studies still find very difficult to value them. This happens also despite the contribution of visuals to answer important questions, such as how cultural global change takes place. What is more, So far, there is a dearth of research about the role visual images play in affecting, more than other factors, people's mindset. As a matter of fact, we live in a world dominated by images in which satellite data, drone technology, closed circuit television, and surveillance cameras control us 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, all year around. While new digital technologies and cyberspace allow for a rapid distribution of still and moving images across the globe. What is more, computer vision, which is the field of artificial intelligence that trains computer to detect, track, and classify visual objects, digital media platforms such as a video streaming, powerhouse Netflix, and advent of image-based social platforms like Pinterest and Instagram, all these elements play an important role across the social domain and economic and political spectrum. From terrorist recruitment like Daesh, ISIS, to social justice campaigns like Occupy Wall Street, Me Too, Black Lives Matter, including conspiracy movements like QAnon. Based on World Steam data, in 2018, 95 million photos and videos were shared on Instagram per day, while over 40 billion photos and videos have been shared on the Instagram platform since its conception in 2010. As a result, still and moving images dominate the world by deeply affecting how we view and approach global phenomena as diverse as climate change, education, diplomacy, war, pandemic, and global financial crisis. What is more, because of their resemblance to the real world they depict, visual images have the power to mobilize people and meaning. But being visual images media representation, their power remains always problematic. In a recent crisis in culture, philosopher Hannah Arendt suggested that a market-driven media would lead to the displacement of culture by the dictates of the entertainment. In this lecture, I'm focusing on one particular class of images, which I identified and categorized as condensation symbols and other visual ideological markers of globality. And I understand them through the lenses of sociopolitical theory in order to investigate their ideological and emotional nature, charged nature. I'm going to analyze and interpret those images of the global, not in terms of truth, but in terms of their epistemic function in creating a meaning and symbolic power. In this respect, I argue that visuality and therefore visual images not only contribute to produce and reproduce the idea of the global, but even more important, they suggest, support, and sustain the symbolic and social production of people's common sense of the global in their everyday life at a local global scale. I will apply a transdisciplinary approach to globalization, and I intend to move away from the Western hegemony and the unit of analysis of the nation state or the global city. I want to understand the global transformation of culture by focusing on the visual dimensions of globalization. Let me observe that scientific data show that images can have a far greater emotional impact on people than words. This potential makes photography a prime candidate for interpretation based on confirmation bias. I refer to the tendency to interpret evidence as a confirmation on one existing beliefs and or theory. This is the reason why my academic research, I always critically reflect on the limitation represented by my own position as a researcher and producer of the given body of visual evidence, usually grounding my work. But let's better identify three concepts which are at the core of this lecture: global, the visual, and the symbolic. About the global, I understand the current process of globalization is a process of a continuous ideological fragmentation, which also involves a constant reconfiguration of the visual order. A visual global order understood as a regime of representation where cultural differences linked to local national culture are turned into global commodification. Since concurring with the media theorist Roberta Sun, neoliberal globalization commodifies all spheres of existence. I found it useful to clarify that my approach to visual globalization does not go back to an understanding of aesthetics as the limited philosophical study of the nature of art, beauty, or taste, but to the Greek aesthetic practice and concept of aesthesis, which combines sensation with imagination, is not necessarily in opposition to intellection. I make use of the concept and practice of aesthesis as sensuous apprehensions in the widest sense. I'm citing Martin Heidegger. Thus, sensation and imagination ground the rhetoric of globalization in my research is a visual, discursive, and interpretative process. Classical theory sees a continuity between reason and emotions, between argumentation and appeal, and between substance and expression to affect res and verba, Latin for things and words. In that sense, I see the local and the global not as a clashing dimensions of globalization, but as a continuum. While I understand the production of the visual regime of representation of the global is a distinct mode of political theory. Philosopher and cultural historian Susan Buck-Morse observed that in a context of global transformation of culture, looking at visual culture as a transdisciplinary field of negotiation rather than a separate discipline can help to move away, I'm citing, from Western hegemony toward the construction of a more global, democratic public sphere. So studying globalization by linking it to visuality means to take into consideration the role that visual technologies and media conglomerates play in the social, political, economical, and cultural change of the society in which we live. It's a matter of fact that the emergence of a global visual culture in which the image dominates other form of symbolic mediation is eclipsing textuality. Therefore, I argue that the intertwined connection between global processes and visuality needs to be understood and explained, and the emergence of a visual regime of the global requires to be critically investigated. So I understand the act of seeing is a creative engagement with the process of thinking and feeling. At the time, I look at the study of visual culture as the study of the social construction of a vision. In that sense, there are no transparent relationships between the production of images and their interpretation. And this is where the criticality, if you like, the weakness of the image beyond its epistemic function in creating meaning and their symbolic power resides. But we will discuss this topic soon. Now, I am briefly going to focus on the power and the perils of symbols as persuasive tools in the study and the research on globalization. Symbol is a word of Latin and Greek origin with the meanings of combination and sign of recognition. A symbol is a mark or character used to represent an object, a function, or process, essentially an item that represents another meaning or value. Figuratively, it is an element like a sign, gesture, I'm gesturing a lot, object, animal, person capable of arousing in the mind an idea different from that offered by its immediate sensitive aspect. Political scientist Murray Edelman, in his body of work dedicated to the symbolic uses of politics, observed that if we seek to learn something about expressive political symbols, we must learn from aesthetics theory, I'm citing, since an art form consists of condensation symbols. Edelman's exploration of condensation symbols is fundamental to an understanding of the symbolic construction of social or collective meaning. This understanding originates from a psychoanalytical perspective, looking at the power of emotional negotiation of symbols in politics. Concurring with Edelman, a condensation symbol evokes the emotion associated with the situation and condense into one symbolic event, sign, or act, like patriotic pride. Think, for instance, of the Capitol Hill violent uprising of Trump's supporters against the authority of the state and of the democratic process of the 6th of January. In that sense, all political acts are condensation symbols. I like to stress that in my research, I am not interested in the symbolic use of politics, as Edelman does, but in the investigation of the symbolic power of some media representation of the global and their function in the social construction of the global imaginaries and as a result of the production of the common sense of the global. Beyond the weakness and the surplus value of images, it can be argued that people need the symbols to understand what otherwise we would not be able to represent and produce. And similarly to what happens for ideologies in our everyday life, we always produce and consume symbolic forms, we are aware of it or not. This happens at any level and a hierarchy of geographic scale of the global, and not only in the global or fast globalizing cities across the globe, as Saskia Sassen suggests, including the different materiality of the World Wide Web. In this respect, let me observe that while I share Saskia Sassen's conceptual considerations in researching and localizing the global, I disagree when she stated that research techniques and data sets generated by the researcher have a little to do with an understanding of globalization dynamics. This is because the symbolic power of the visual is the ability to construct the global imaginary in a single place, event, or image by turning a local place into a global microplace. So, in addressing the question of how visual images respond to globalization and how they contribute to shape it, we need to expand our knowledge about image theory in relation to the dynamics of globalization. This is also the reason why my research suggests that to detect and understand the global and how globalization forces affect local national meaning, we can analyze and interpret even a single image, which condenses different layers of meaning of the local, national, and the global, as per my condensation symbols and other visual ideological markers of globality. In assessing the state of relationship between the global and the visual by means of the symbolic order, this lecture aims to contribute to the debate on how knowledge about the symbolic and the social dimension of globalization is constitute in the field of study of political theory from an alternative visual discursive aesthetics standpoint. But before going ahead, I wish to share with you an example of a condensation symbol of globality in which the popular American rapper and singer Pitbull Armando Christian Perez, the global icon Jennifer Lopez, and the Brazilian singer and television personality Claudia Leitte perform We Are One. It's from the official FIFA World Opening Ceremony at the Arena de São Paulo in Brazil on 12 June 2014. The performance works as a global appeal for a global awareness.
So fans are finished. Yeah. And I'm
Well, hoje é tudo nosso. Quando eu chamo o mundo inteiro pra jogar, pra mostrar que eu posso. E chorar, sorrir, não importa o resultado.
Now, in considering the value of symbolic representation, no matter if still or moving, I claim that visual images of the global are noteworthy devices not only to better understand globalization as a material and ideational process, but also to better understand the overlying ideology of globalization and their critique with regard to their ability to affect and shape people's mindset. What is more, visual images paradoxically also help to explore what is immediately not visible by enriching the limited textual philosophical approach to globalization by means of more inclusive visual discursive methodology. This is because symbols are also the human's attempt to make our values publicly available for display. Otherwise, unless spoken or seen in action, those values are invisible. Symbols are therefore assumed to evoke also abstract entities, such as the planet Earth, seen from the other spaces as a symbol of globalization. Here, I offer an alternative approach to globalization, which is transdisciplinary by its very nature and global in its approach and methodology, because I also make use of the method of visual analysis and interpretation of global iconology. An ideological approach to visual globalization involves a critique of relations of meaning between the local, national, and the global to better understand the way power is constructed and channeled by symbolic forms of various kinds, from everyday linguistic utterances to complex images and text. However, let me observe that such relations of meaning are actually relations of power between the local, national, and global, reproduced by the continuous spread of transnational visual imagery, which contributes to construct and mobilize meaning in the social world. In this presentation, as previously acknowledged, I claim that beyond the symbolism and the unit of analysis of the global city, of the nation state, beyond the limited textual philosophical approach of political theory to globalization, we can detect, explain, and understand the global even by analyzing and interpreting only one single image, act, or event. To provide a practical example, I am going to carry out a brief case study of one evidence related to the visual order of the global in the socio-historical settings of London, UK, and Melbourne in Australia. I wish to better understand how the intertwined dynamics of the global and the visual affect local meaning at every scale of a hierarchy of the global, and even more interestingly, at deep subjective levels affecting people's social imaginaries and ideology. Founded in 2006 in the United Kingdom, currently Laka Mobile is the world's largest international mobile virtual network operator and has been ranked number one in the telecom sector in a new brand experience index, ahead of brands such as British Telecom, O2, and Vodafone. Laka Mobile states that its mission is to connect friends and family around the world by providing low-cost, high-quality calls, texts, and data. They have over 60 million customers across 24 countries, including Russia, United States, Italy, Netherlands, and South Africa, and they plan further expansion. But today I'm interested in using the lenses of sociopolitical theory to understand how Laka Mobile, with their global marketing campaigns, contribute to people's symbolic and social construction of the common sense of the global, not only by connecting people globally, which is their job, but even more important, through the epistemic power of their strategic visual communication campaigns. A brand communication which usually links the symbol of the global man to the idea of the whole, by suggesting connecting the local with the global and at the same time supporting and sustaining the idea of a world as a whole by means of communication and interaction, even if in a context of increasing unacceptable persistence of digital divide. Historian Christian Jacob asserts that the terrestrial globe exists only in the imagination of the viewer, familiar with the visual codes of maps. If a world map allows the vision of the whole, the atlas brings an encyclopedic, a dynamic mastery of the world. The totality is grasped through the accumulation of partial views as a quantitative effect and as a visual zooming through the scale of cartographic representation. The sphere itself provides a different and an additional degree of minds to an understanding of globalization. You can stand in front of the world, even if this can have, concurring with the cultural geographer Dennis Cosgrove, symbolic consequences by providing cosmological implications. So the terrestrial globe is not only a map, but also a statement about the material model of the world, what Latins define imago mundi, image of the world, and a different geo-epistemological device. So it can be said that the global citizen of the third millennium is an expression of the capitalistic transformation into the homo visualis, a new form of human being visually gifted and assisted by the development of visual technologies and computer visions, continuously globally connected, allowing digital capitalism to cash the cow of digitalization by maximizing their profits. Therefore, while at the site of reception, Laka Mobile, a global man suggests the idea of the old as a whole, it also makes us feel a global citizen by means of a visual and conceptual abstraction. This happens because, ideally, by paying a cheap price, we are and feel globally interconnected. As a matter of fact, we remain more than ever locally grounded, while globally exploited by the maximization of profits operated by transnational and or global media conglomerates and network operators like a mobile. Paradoxically, the rise and spread of national populistic ideologies across the globe, primarily opposing neoliberal globalization in favor of the ideological power and the sovereignty of the nation state, are made possible by the ideological echo chambers made available by the global media conglomerates such as Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, YouTube, and the networks providers like Lika Mobile, representative of the global corporate capitalism that the rioters ideally wish to fight. So it can be said that while the contradictions are everywhere, the reconfiguration of the current morphological and ideological global landscape clearly display the complexity and contradictory elements that are a part of the reglobalization of the world under present conditions. To wrap up, in my lecture, I have addressed several research questions related to the intertwined incestuous relationship between the global and the visual. And I explained that images have no power in themselves because we give power to them since we need them as a means of communication. In discussing the use of visual images in political theory, I focused especially on how the epistemic function and symbolic power of the visual, the photographic image in particular, can contribute to structure the global inside the local by also redefining the state of globality. Research findings helped on the one hand to exemplify the complex and abstract notion of the global at the site of reception, on the other hand to problematize the phenomenological nature of globalization. I use the transdisciplinary global approach, the method of global iconology, to understand the visual dimension of globalization. I did it fully aware that it is almost impossible to be objective. So I tried to be as much detached as possible. However, my position could hide some of the bias or hopes that all of us have. I argued that the visual regime of representation and signification of the global displays symbolic dominations that contributes to reshape people's social imaginings and ideology at a deep subjective level, while contributing to destabilize the modern self-contained idea of the nation state at a local scale. This especially happens with the new figures of knowledge of the global I categorize as condensation symbols and other visual ideological markers of globality. Although the cases I considered in this lecture, the images grounding it can be limited in their representation of people, places, and identities, I argue that they are constitutive of the visual regime of representation and the signification of the global, and that for this reason, it was worth to take them into consideration. To conclude, I am aware that these images depicting the global local dynamics leave the way open to many interpretations, but I am sure that we can agree on the importance of them to better understand globalization and the need to take them seriously, particularly this complex visual construct of the global age in which we live. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Tommaso.
Thank you, Peter.
We can open it up for questions. There was something that I was wondering initially if you could address, because, you know, it's funny, in film and media studies, there's a slightly different language that we use to talk about this, but regarding the issue of how to thematize the global through visual symbols, the one issue that comes up with the very terminology of the global has to do with symbolic as a cultural idiom. And I get the sense that you're arguing that the global is a certain type of global idiom that can be thematized through visual representation. But the problem then becomes the issue of a sort of a specific identification of the use of visual language in relationship to a community of meaning, or a way in which those who are watching or serve as recipients or points of identification interpret them. So how do you deal with that question? Because you mentioned this concept of condensation, a psychoanalytic or kind of concept, but that's only possible if there's a sort of structure that's somehow shared, and usually communities might overlap, but they're usually somewhat narrow in terms of a kind of cultural context for reading or textual readings in terms of interrelated texts. So how do you address that particular question, or how are you thinking about it?
Very good, Peter, thank you. This is really a very interesting reply from my side. The interesting aspect of my condensation symbols and visual ideological markers of globality already define a particular class of images which condenses some occasion. Think, for instance, the clip related to the opening ceremony in San Paolo. It's really a condensation of different layers of meaning, not only meanings, but also different media, mixed media, languages, images, theater, performance, and so on. That really, in the football clubs, that very well condense this idea of a condensation symbols of the global. And they were singing, they sing, we are one, which really work as, we are one. So as you can understand, we are one can be understood in the same way anywhere, even if in a context or different socio-historical formation. Also, the most important thing from my understanding of these theoretical tools, these thinking tools, if you like, to call it in this way, of the condensation symbols and visual ideological marks of globality, in particular, the ideological marker of globality works as a decontested ideological representation. Means that in some way, the planet Earth, for instance, means the same thing everywhere, globally, we can say. So it's the process of ideological decontestation that these type of images produce that make them to be not universal understood, but very much agreed, very much, understood as they are. When we look at the reproduction, the media reproduction, which is a visual construction of the planet Earth from the outer space, all of us, doesn't matter which type of languages, where we are located, understand we are talking about. And interestingly, in the advanced country, but as well as in the global south, The idea of the planet Earth and understood as the symbol of globalization is very much accepted. So as you can understand, there is a double register with these images. They work in a decontested way, but at the same time, local place contribute to give meaning to them. You can say that there is a contradiction, but as I said before, contradictions are everywhere.
Kim wanted to speak, and then David, and Jan.
Thank you. Tommaso, that was very interesting, and really liked your choice of symbols and images and stuff. Quite powerful. But you're welcome. I want to challenge, raise something from a different angle, perhaps, please. And that is your definition of globalization, and that is you're using a single model of globalization, representing it very well. But I would argue that a better understanding is a double representation, both globalization from the top down and globalization from the bottom up. Let me give you an example from my recent book. I study labor around the world. I don't know if you could see this very well, my latest book.
Wow.
But it's a picture of me on what they call a tricycle with wings in rural Mindanao. In the Philippines.
Yeah. All right. I know Mindanao. I was in Mindanao, so I know very well what you are talking about.
Okay. 20 years ago. Okay, good. But the point being is that if we understand that there's a globalization from below that is contesting the globalization from above that you are showing so well, you're analyzing that part well. But what about the people on the bottom and how their efforts are not anti-globalization, but they're seeking a globalization on its own, but with different values, different organizations, things such as this that truly span the world and seek a globalization from below, but based on the values of solidarity and equality, rather than top-down values of domination and hierarchy. And we also have to recognize the top-down globalization is always backed by military force, whether it's used or not. And certainly the United States has been, you know, the preeminent example of that, but I wouldn't limit it to them as well. So could you comment on that?
Thank you very much, Kim. You are absolutely right. I totally agree with you. But the problem is with a lecture lasting 40 minutes, you can't do everything. And Jan told me, Tommaso, don't tell us everything. Maybe you want to invite me in another occasion. So I try to leave it in myself. This is a job that I'm already doing, really. And my visual archive is already full of images from Brazil, Philippines, the country in the south of the world. So yes, they have a different position, for sure. They contribute in a different way, that is an antagonist way, it is an alternative to globalization. But as explained from the beginning, I was looking at particular global images related to the commodification of the world produced by neoliberal globalization. So I agree with you. You are absolutely right. This is a job that I'm already doing. I will do next time because it's even more interesting. As you can see, I was talking about the digital divide. This is a very interesting theoretical frame to understand globalization from the South, because you know better than me, beyond the control of the internet, a digital divide creates a problem for maybe next century to these countries in the global south. So we need to address this.
Okay, if I may follow up just for a moment, is I don't confine this globalization from below just to the global south. Yeah. Those of us in the global north that are supporting these same values are just as involved as people from the global south. So I don't want to, I don't think we should.
Yeah, you are absolutely right. I was limited in my reply. For instance, in Europe, we have, even in Italy, where I come from, in Italy, half of the country is almost like US these days. There are half of the country against globalism, you know, the Liga Nord, all these stuffs, and this needed to be addressed. So it's not only about the global south, but you used the word the global south, so I decided to. Of course, we can understand it. We are on the same page, Kim. And thank you for joining me.
Thank you.
My turn. Great. Tomas, first and foremost, it's so nice to see you. It's great to see you.
Wow. After, I think, 5 years or 4 or 5
yeah,
years.
It's been a while. Absolutely. That said, I really agree with your thesis. I think it's a very important thesis. But I want to stretch you just for a moment, if that's okay. And to me, there's a very important thing that you're hinting at in this study. And what you're hinting at to me is the idea of globalization as a kind of trope. Or for lack of a better term, I'll call it the global trope.
Correct.
Because I'm sorry. Yeah,
you
yeah.
You did some job on this.
Yeah, yeah. And what's unclear to me in your presentation is, on the one hand, I see globalization as being powerfully invoked through the visual. Mm. And emotive stuff is coming to the surface and so forth. But what's not clear to me is, with globalization being invoked, who's benefiting from it? Who's not benefiting from it? Are we talking about real estate capital here? Are we talking about finance capital? Are we talking about national governances? Globalization is a profoundly relational concept to me. And it should always, when we conceptualize it, we should always reference who's promulgating it and who stands to benefit from it. So I'd appreciate your comments on that.
Yeah, David, thank you for joining me today. And you are absolutely right. In some way, your question follow Kim question about the different perspective on globalization. It's interesting, you know, with the visuality, it doesn't matter if you are looking from the global south or from the global north. You really can understand much more than a usual textual philosophical approach to globalization. Who can benefit from this? I think everyone, the research in the first instance, political theory, because I'm pushing very much political theory to acknowledge the power of images in their study, in their research, in their understanding of globalization. So everyone can benefit, like visual literacy. Look, I think that these days, David, if I have some power, I will suggest to make visual critical literacy, visual rhetorically, you know, compulsory in the curriculum of master study, because how you can manage this day, how you can handle an understanding of the complex cultural object that submerges us in our everyday life without a knowledge about a critical approach to the visual. Yeah. So from my standpoint, anyone can benefit
Sure. Let me just make a very quick comment, because to me, globalization is a process that there are some people and institutions that stand to benefit enormously from the common conception of globalization and policy that creates it. But it's also a very acutely punishing phenomenon. Mm-hmm. And it punishes especially the marginalized, the poor, for example, in our cities. The racialized poor, when resources go towards creating glittery, you know, cities, which take away from a politics of a politics of redistribution and goes towards a politics of economic growth. So I think it's a real mixed bag, and I think we have to be very important about seeing who benefits from it, and through this creation of the visual, that so profoundly promulgates it. But that would be my point, yeah.
Yeah, but I totally agree with you, David. We need to do this job and we need to redefine globalization, yep. Not mm-hmm. only from an understanding perspective of the reglobalization because of the rise of populist ideology across the globe, but also right. because of the inequality, of the yep. increasing economic inequality. And can I tell you one thing, David? I'm still a casual academic. I don't know if I will work or not next semester. You know, and my course, they are always very, students across the globe enjoy because are very interactive, very visually grounded. You know, I try to speak their language, but I am the product of neoliberal globalization. So as you can see, we need to do this job. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you.
Jan?
Tommaso, mille grazie. And I walk in the muds, the wet muds of Monrovia in Liberia, and I look up and I see giant billboards of Colgate toothpaste and Nestle products. So the visual then gives me emotion, but coded and patterned in a particular way, which touches on what Kim and David were also saying. So I think the import, the strengths, the appeal of your contribution is to bring out the emotional dimension. And at the same time, clearly these emotions are patterned and coded. And I know that when you share screen, you cannot see the chat, but when you look at the chat, several people commented, also David Willis commented on the coded nature. So in a certain way, worldwide, we need from people financial citizenship, that they are aware, critically aware of what finance does in the world. And we also need visual citizenship in that we, our consumption, our processing, our exposure to images, in what way they are liberating, evoke solidarity and social cohesion, and in which way they are coded, patterned by algorithms that have been fine-tuned through focus groups and so on and so forth. And this is a very fine line, critical edge. The Sao Paulo episode you showed, I thought was the most fun and exhilarating. And this goes back to All You Need Is Love as a world music event, the first world wide event, which evokes in us the sacred images that go back to the pyramids and the pilgrimage and so on and so forth. We go from sacred images to images of power and war, to images of commerce and now advertisements. So there is a kind of a visual journey that is an emotional journey for the species. And we see images of the globe, and all these images of the Earth as a blue sphere ignore the context of the universe that it is part of. So there is a kind of evocation and isolation at the same time. But I think the emotional part, Tommaso, is the most interesting and evocative contribution of your work. I appreciate it much. I think there is a question in if you want comment.
Thank you very much, Jan. I very well understand that really your question, as you are aware, well connected with Kim, with David, even with Peter at the beginning. There is a fil rouge, if I can use, between your question, that the problem is a better, a wider understanding of globalization. And this needed to be done, but once again, I'm focusing in this lecture on the neoliberal globalization and on the commodification of this whole sphere of existence that neoliberal politics or economic politics means. So when you tell me about Liberia, I very well understand this is the reason why I used to try to tell you that I'm looking at the social construction of the vision, not at seeing just to see or to perceive what is happening. Of course, we can talk about visual colonization, which is one of the most, terrible experience, not only in the South, but everywhere. There was, a form of colonialism. So the point is, it depends by the perspective we look at. We can't talk about everything and we can't approach. I try to do something not little wider, but in the deep of my research, of my thinking, because for me, this is a great occasion to share with you, rock star of globalization, my research. I'm an humble, scholar, that's it. Nothing more, but thank you very much. I agree with you. So we are on the same page. The problem is to move from one perspective to another or to better include different perspective. But in particular, when you like to critically analyze the visuals, you need to go into the deep. You can't do everything.
Thanks. Maybe we should cooperate in some fashion and write something together, many of us.
I was going to say real quickly that you can take a life career academically of unpacking the term visual citizenship, which would be a great project.
Oh, yeah, thank you very much, of course.
I mean, that would be really intriguing for someone to do.
I will do, yeah, I will let you know. Yeah, I will acknowledge your suggestion. I was talking of visual, homo visualis, so in relation to citizenship, global citizenship.
Yeah.
So homo visualis is maybe visual citizenship,
It's a really intriguing term.
But maybe we could pick up on that theme that Jan brought up about, he calls it emotional visuality, but in film and media studies, we often talk about affect through image production. So for example, whether it's a still image or whether it's video or film, we often talk about the constructed nature of the image itself in terms of provoking a kind of reaction or reactive state. And that's one of the kind of universal features that a number of different fields seem to be interested in. And I'm wondering what your perspective is on this idea of universal affect and the extent to which it addresses the way in which you're engaging with conceptualizing the global.
Yeah, you are absolutely right, Peter. The problem of understanding emotion, connecting emotion with sensation, with conceptual, theoretical, analytical frame, it's what helped me to understand the idea of the global. But beyond the emotion, beyond the ideological and emotional nature of these, the images grounding my work and I shared with you, the point is that I understand this emotion connected to the ideology to express, to interpret at the same time this product, this cultural object together, because I can't see a separation. As I told you before, I refer to an idea of aesthesis, not of aesthetics. I mean, an understanding of a wider way of aesthetic, which include almost everything, include the social world in which we live, all our senses. I know it's a large vision of the world, but this is because this approach helped me to take things together. Otherwise, I need always to separate, to split them. And I tell you, I can better understand by approaching, by following the classic approach, taking together emotion and sensation, emotion and ideology, emotion and meaning, you know. Of course, these open up, to interpretation. Maybe we can interpret differently the same image. But I think with this particular type of images, like the visual ideological marks of globality, there is something that is understood everywhere in the same way. We agree or disagree. We are in favor or we are against. Doesn't matter if you are a part of the social movement or we are, you know, from the elite group of giant teachers, leading the world, doing the politics these days. So as you can understand, this process of ideological decontextualization helped me to take all together and to better understand what is happening with this some form, some type of specific images. I'm not talking about all images, but these thinking tools of condensation symbols and visual ideological markers. I think Kim
had something to contribute, and then Jan.
Okay, I think one of the questions that's just sitting here that perhaps you haven't focused on is the issue of power, in that whose images and images of what are getting projected on the global scale. So for example, you can take the work of David Bacon, who is a photojournalist who does wonderful work dealing with immigrants, usually farm worker immigrants in California, coming from Mexico on up. Is those images in general are not getting projected around the world, but they're images that everybody can understand. So the idea of what these largely corporations are projecting gives us a whole different angle. And I think we've got to look at the issue of power on going back to the basics of before we start talking about what images and how they are, but whose images and who decides which images get projected.
You are absolutely right, Kim. I share with you your position because this is the reason why I'm talking about neoliberal globalization, commodification of everything, almost our life. You know, think about Facebook, for instance. They sell your images. If you are a part of a Facebook, you produce the image, you do the job, they exploit you, you put your image, and you buy your image. So it's paradoxically, you know, but this is because global capitalism, global corporate capitalism, digital capitalism or platform capitalism, if you like, have this possibility, works in this way. They can maximize the profit through a 24-hour cycle by doing mining, you know, of everything, and by selling you your own images.
Tommaso, more than just profiting, it's seizing, if you will, public space and deciding what's going to be there. And they're loading up the public space with their images that are related to capitalism, to commodification and things like that, excluding, because there are limits, if nothing else, so 24 hours, how many images can you see? They are excluding. So it's more than profitability. We've got to go deeper than that, I think.
But we are always limited, Kim, and imperfect in some way. And we can't ask global capitalism to show us everything. No, please, it's already too much. But I agree with you. In this game, a lot of people doing a great job are not seen, are invisible, and this is a shame. So unless you accept the rule of digital capitalism this day, otherwise you are out. Of course, they show whatever they want, you know. Where, but they make money with everything, so doesn't care.
You know. Jan? I think Jan wanted it, and then David.
Okay, yeah, just a little note. Say, there is so many representations, Tommaso, about the globe, the earth, globalization, and so forth. And there is a French discussion, as you know, that the emphasis would be very interesting to put the emphasis on world, monde, mondialisation, worldization. And when we say world, it immediately becomes historical and geographical. It is ground, and there is a profound nuance here. So the evocations of the globe are things abstract and kind of stratospheric. When we bring it back to the world, we become more worldly in our understanding. That's just and one more note. Look, one of your key points is the continuum. And when you bring out the visuals as an emotional space, it is also a cerebral space, because it coded increasingly in the neoliberal through algorithms and so forth. And this continuum is interesting to work with. An interesting point. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Jan. I think you are right. This is the reason why I was talking during my lecture about looking at epistemic power of imaging, create meaning, you know. You are absolutely right. We almost, whatever we do, we always work with our imagination, with our, you know, mental image. And the mental image always overlaps the real one. But the real one, it's really not the real one. It's already a representation. And this is the difficulty, if you like, from one end, the surplus value of the image, but also its weakness, because we can approach from any perspective, any point of view, and you know, it's open up to an interpretation, while a statement, it's a clear statement. But my opinion is we cannot, you know, avoid or disregard the value of the image on the research, on the study of globalization. I never stop to push this, you know.
Mm-hmm. David?
I was just going to say really quickly that to me, every image that you showed was the most we get a superficial glimpse into an unfolding, evolving political economy. And with great caution, we truncate that from the mechanics of how globalization is produced and reproduced. But we should, and this really is Kim's point, I believe, we should never, I think, remove ourselves from the quest to understanding power, both as a process of capital accumulation and power as something that's quested for in and of itself. And all of those images are the leading edge of something complex that is going on.
Yeah, your analysis, I can share your analysis, David, because we deal with the surfaces, you know, we deal with the depiction, we deal with the images. Image, it's a very complex, you can teach a cultural object, you know, we can't, but we cannot stop on the surface of representation. We need to dig into the deep of the surface, what is beyond, what is invisible. And this is the reason why, you know, these working with image open up questions, raise a lot of questions, because open up to interpretation and to different point of view. But I think this is a part of the democratic approach of visualization. This is a part of a process of inclusiveness, different from the ideological border of the text, of the philosophical approach. And this is the reason that I'm suggesting to put things together, because they are together. So when you look at the surface of the representation, your mind starts thinking about a lot of things.
Yeah. Let me invite some others who haven't spoken yet, if they'd like to contribute any comments or perspectives or questions. Yes, David Willis.
Thank you so much, Tommaso. Absolutely fascinating talk. And I was particularly taken by the unisphere, the globe that is in the Flushing Meadows, which coincidentally, ironically, is also called Corona Park. Yeah, here we are with the Corona, which is, the great irony. We're all together, right? We're all together, but we're all apart. It's kind of those things. But I have a question about the epistemic side, which is how do we decolonize our perspectives here? And Jan was talking too. He took us off of the earth too a bit there to put us in the universe, and including these earth-centric perspectives we have. I continue to reflect too on the global extraction story that is going on here. But at the same time, I do think we have some agency. We saw the agency with J-Lo at the inauguration last week, where she spoke in Spanish. It was so wonderful to hear that. This land is your land, America the beautiful, and then some Spanish at us. It was just great. But how do we decolonize our perspectives? We're so colonized by all of these things.
David, first of all, thank you very much for joining us this morning for your question. I think that we are full of bias, theories, immersed in our ideologies. So it's an hard job, really, to do a work in the analysis and interpretation of this type of images in particular, because they are really very, in their superficiality, they are very much ideologically and emotionally charged. It's difficult to detach. We do this job to a certain extent. I try to be detached. I try not to think about myself, but for sure, when I'm analyzing one of these images, I always think a better globalization is possible, not only this neoliberal one. So as you can see, so it's a part of the process. But we can do something. It's like to operate a sort of ecology of the vision. We decide don't look, don't think, don't talk about something, rather, focusing on something else. Maybe your suggestion to look from the perspective of theoretical frame of the global side. To globalization. It means through the perspective also of the social forum, of the social justice, and so on. Okay, we can do a lot of things, of course. But today, my work was focused on this aspect of neoliberal globalization, which include your, colonized. feeling we are all colonized. It doesn't matter, because if you think that even our revolutionary approach, when this happens, are brought to us from global media conglomerate, makes sense, because if we approach through a political economic frame, I used to do this, I used to put Marxism and feminism together to better understand my images, I try to go beyond, of course. But again, if you put this in your approach to the visual, this type of theory, you can do a good job. However, this doesn't mean that I feel not colonized, because it's the condition. This is the point. is the condition in which we live that make us, we cannot escape, is the capitalism, you know, is the system, is the mechanism of capitalism, and this in particular digital platform capitalism that doesn't provide any escape for anyone, even those that wish ideally to fight it. Think about, you know, the global eco chambers, just to tell you how populistic nationalism, this ideology is the new nationalist ideology, were spread by the global network across the globe. Not locally, yeah, of course, local place contribute, but generally speaking, the global media conglomerate that produced this type. But as you can see, they can't do anything against global capitalism because they sell you your images, the images of your life. The cycle is concluded.
Mm-hmm. So another comment by Daniel, I think.
Please, Daniel.
Yeah, thanks very much. Maybe a little bit of skepticism towards the end then from my side. Please, I was sitting here and just wondering, maybe what we're looking at with these images is an outcome of the search for a language of the global. And obviously, since the global means many different languages, the image sort of is the natural thing to go for. And in the boring world we live in, of course, these new languages are first pushed forward by these transnational corporations that already dominate this global sphere. So somehow it's clear that they will sort of occupy first. But I was sitting here and all the time thinking, but there's so many nice other examples of how images are being produced to address something that is on the global, on the universal emotional level, like the memes I already wrote about in the chat about it. This is for me like a global imaginary produced from the South, an emerging language maybe. We communicate across different languages. And therefore I'm a little bit more optimistic actually here on this side that the imaginary can be quite nicely occupied. And that's from my side.
Mm-hmm. Daniel, thank you for joining us from Europe, globalization, as you can see. But I can agree with you. Look, the problem is, once again, I was not approaching to an aesthetics standpoint images. For me, images not needed to be beautiful, needed to be, you know, useful to my research. So this is the reason why I was careful in explaining my approach was to a theoretical frame of a wider aesthesis, including almost everything. For me, even just a scratch, a boat, something, a piece of rubbish is useful to understand what I am doing. So the point is, sometimes the trap is there are a lot of beautiful things telling in a different way, and maybe more interesting way, something. But I was looking at neoliberal globalization as a commodification of our existence through the frame, through, by approaching to, you know, the frame of the visuality, of the visual images. So I was looking at a specific type of cultural construct. I hope I answered your question.
Yeah, sure. Thanks.
Thank you.
Any further comments or questions before we go? Yes, David Willis.
Oh, David.
Oh, he was on his way out. He was waving goodbye.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you, Tommaso. This was really wonderful. Really appreciate it. Were there any other final comments you might wanted to make before we go?
Really, I enjoyed very much the time I spent with you. This morning I woke up very early, but usually I do this even without having any commitment. And thank you so much for your passionate participation. Kim, I enjoyed very much all your questions. And of course, I've already your book on my list. So was good to meet over the global capitalistic, you know, space of Zoom. Look how it works. Well, it was great to meet really all of you. I hope we will have in the near future, maybe other occasion, maybe to collaborate together. I would love, Peter, you are in the same, almost the same field. We speak from different perspectives. Sometimes we don't understand each other because we use terms and, you know, understanding a concept from a different background. But of course, I'm sure we can find a meeting point of negotiation. Thank you so much.
Really. Absolutely. Thank you so much, Tommaso. And thanks to everyone for joining. We really appreciate it. And I know Brett will be in touch with the next event as well. So thanks very much, Brett, as well.
Thank you. As a matter, if it's possible, I will be with you.
Wonderful. Wonderful. Thank you so much. Take care. Take care to everyone, to William.
All of you. Thank you. Thank you, Peter. Thank you, Brad.
All of you. Tommaso.